The coronavirus is the biggest threat this country has faced for decades, and this country is not alone.
Let's do our due diligence, take the precautions we need to take care of ourselves.
No matter what, I still love my job, and I'm going to do everything in my power to save lives.
कल की बात पुरानी नए दौर में लिखेंगे मिलकर नई कहानी.
So I encountered a patient who has been with me for the last 6 years, was unusually came with a sugar of 250 and 350 in late March, and I found that this was a little too high to be concerned about. And within a day, the patient called me back and said, "Doc, my sugar is 500 today, and I have just not eaten anything inappropriately. There is something else happening. I feel very tired, very fatigued, and my taste has changed. I'm not able to smell well, but I'm able to taste bitter a little bit. And, you know, I feel a little uncomfortable, and I think I have a fever of 101. That actually alerted me. I said, oh, are we dealing with COVID?
This is Dr. Shashank Joshi. He's one renowned Indian doctor and one of the frontline doctors who is risking his life daily, going out and curing people of COVID. He was also felicitated by the Indian government with Padma Shri in 2014. And today he's here with us to give us an actual picture of COVID in our country.
That time, you know, the testing was not freely available. It was very difficult to get a test. So we had to send that patient actually to Kasturba Hospital and get a nasal swab and a throat swab done. And lo and behold, the patient tested positive. And this patient, that time we didn't have too many drugs available, and we were able to give this patient medication, manage his sugar well, was hospitalized for 10 days and came home fine. And the sugars are normal, patient is doing well, and is a COVID survivor, and has gone ahead and got his antibodies tested. He's scared to give plasma even now. I'm trying to motivate him for plasma, but has survived. And that was my first encounter, and I realized that COVID is going to enter all our lives. We were seeing these imports coming from Dubai and abroad, who are the people who are getting positive with COVID and coronavirus. Again, novel, new, uncertainty is the core, predictably unpredictable. So suddenly we started seeing a little mini swarm of cases gradually creeping in. And I thought it's time that we need to handle this pandemic, destigmatize it, because there is more virus in the mind than actually in the body, and try to see whether how we can help more and more people to live with corona, live with COVID, be sensible, and ensure that we do the right thing. You know, the only way to handle COVID is test. Whatever you test, then you, if somebody tests positive, then do the primary and secondary tracing of all the contacts. So the contacts can be high risk, moderate risk, low risk. So try to do contact tracing. And if the contacts also trace positive, then they isolate. So it was test, trace, and isolate, or test, trace, and quarantine from a public health standpoint. But when it came to humko COVID ho gaya, so it is that patient. It is treat and care. And that treat and care is scary. So the first thing I tell every person who tests positive is don't panic. Okay, you could be, most people don't even know they are asymptomatic or pre-symptomatic. But COVID has to have a very pragmatic, systematic, and a clear-cut approach. So the simplest COVID is the nose COVID. COVID is in the nose, and it will have nasal symptoms, and it will have some rhinitis, it might have some sneezing, and usually has self-limiting. Most COVID will go away, lack of smell, lack of taste. Then you have throat COVID, a little more severe COVID. You might have sore throat, you might have change of voice, you might have fever, shortness of breath, and so on and so forth. But again, usually very well treated. Whether you treat it with medicine, without medicine, again, it is going to recover. Then you have the lung COVID. Lung COVID is the one which we can't ignore. We have to be serious. We have to know what has to be done. If somebody is out of breath, somebody is having dry cough, no wet cough, and somebody is having high grade fever, well, and probably the lungs are involved on a CT scan or a X-ray chest, it's lung COVID. But then we start doing the COVID thermometer. The COVID thermometer is the pulse oximeter, and we do the pulse oximetry. And in the oxygen saturation, we do a 6-minute walk test. And after the 6-minute walk test, if the saturation doesn't drop more than 3% or is not less than 92%, you're good. And that is called COVID lung with normal oxygen. Then you have a COVID, which is COVID lung, but oxygen is required. That patient needs to move to a facility, like a corona care facility or hospital. And that is the only COVID. Otherwise, everything else we can manage at home. So that COVID lung on oxygen, where oxygen requirement is less than 4 liters, is again going to become okay. And the rarest COVID, which is less than 3% of people with COVID, are the COVIDs which will get critically ill and they'll land up in ICU. So that's the lung COVID which needs a lot of oxygen. Usually the oxygen from the nose, where in the prone position, you give high flow nasal cannula, and sometimes they need a ventilator. And that time we have to give them either steroids like methylprednisolone, dexamethasone, give sometimes IL-6 blockers like itolizumab or toxicolizumab, or give them plasma therapy. And very few patients who are not so fortunate might need to do a mechanical ventilator where we put a machine lung for them. So that is the different types of COVID. But most COVID can be managed by, we have now medicines to attack the virus. We have an oral tablet called favipiravir. We have an injection called remdesivir, which can be given to moderate to severe COVID. Now, if there is a oxygen requirement, even after giving steroids, it is going up by more than 4 liters, 8 liters, then we have medicines like this IL-6 or the immune modulator monoclonal antibodies, which are biologic drugs like tocilizumab or itolizumab, which can also be given. So COVID has a lot of treatment options available. But what is most crucial is the timing. So prompt treatment, early diagnosis, prompt treatment and treat and care is the order of the day. Early COVID, mild COVID, no comorbidities, no vulnerable populations can be managed at all. So somebody is below 50, doesn't have hypertension, diabetes, doesn't have lung disease, chronic heart disease, chronic kidney disease, chronic liver disease, is not taking too many immunosuppressant or steroid-like medicines, they are the vulnerable group. They can be managed at home. While somebody has the vulnerable conditions or comorbidities, age is more than 50, 55, they need special attention, special care, probably under hospitalized supervision. So we need to segregate, is the COVID mild, is the COVID moderate, is the COVID severe, and is it in the first 8-10 days or is it in the next 8-10 days? In the first week, it's the virus which is active. It is in the second week, it is the immune reaction which is active. And the third week is usually the recovery time. So the second week is the crucial week. And in that week, we get something where the saturation drops down, the oxygenation drops down. And we call this situation as happy hypoxia. That means patient is hale and hearty. He doesn't know that he has a problem. He feels he has recovered. But actually the saturation is coming down. So it is called as happy hypoxia. Hypoxia means less oxygen in the body. Okay. And that is why they need oxygen. So treatment of COVID is oxygen, oxygen, oxygen. Okay. And that is how it is. I think the asymptomatic cases are carriers and can be spreaders and super spreaders. But asymptomatic cases are able to handle the virus well. Now what happens is we are Indians, so we know how to handle symptoms. So if you just feel tired, if you have exertion, if you have a little fever in the evening, you have a little chills in the evening, you have severe pain in the calf, you have severe backache, you know, you don't count it as a COVID symptom. So many people are actually symptomatic, but they don't know that these are unusual symptoms of COVID or simple diarrhea. So a lot of our asymptomatics actually have symptoms which are subtle or mild, which we don't attribute it to the COVID symptom. So that is we are under a learning curve, number one. Number two, in the first 9 days of a asymptomatic case, the virus is actively replicating. And when the virus is actively replicating, what is happening? That person could potentially spread. So our advice is somebody is positive, mask, mask and mask. And preferably wear an N95 mask because we don't want you to transmit it to others. So that is the main thing. So if you are able to mask, and if two people mask, even if both are COVID positive, the chances of transmission are less than 0.5%. Because we know now that it is transmitted by an airborne droplet, both big droplet and small droplet or micro droplet. And we can reduce the risk of transmission by simple masking. So if you do this SMS, which is simple sanitization, simple masking and social distancing, you can go a long way. We can actually break the chain. So asymptomatic people are good that India has such a large asymptomatic people. They are recovering on their own. But they need to do SMSing because they are the ones who don't know that they have COVID. Hospital-based care, which we have devised for our state, for example, I'm on the Maharashtra COVID Task Force, are fundamentally three categories. One is home-based care, which is the quarantine and home-based care. Second is the hospital-based care, but they need oxygen, which are corona care facilities, which are there, which are like the field hospitals which were created in Mumbai city, they are created in Delhi. These are the field hospitals. They come there, they get oxygen, they get basic care and supportive care. See, COVID care is all about supportive care. And very rarely, I don't do intensive care, but for intensive care or critical care experts are inside the ICU, treating patients inside the ICU with this nasal, high flow nasal ventilator or non-invasive ventilator or ventilator care. And that is where we use all these high-tech medicines like the immunological agents like monoclonal antibodies, steroid therapy, or these agents like remdesivir, which is an antiviral drug, or we use the mechanical ventilator. So that is where, that is the protocol. So it's an evolving protocol. Also, we realize that it is not just inflammation and immunology. There's a lot of clotting, and we need to use these anti-clotting agents like heparin or the antiplatelet agents like novel anticoagulants, because we don't want to lose our patients because of clotting episodes. And we have every day one new therapy comes in this COVID, because it's a new virus. So, you know, like the buzzword last week might have been colchicine. This week, the buzzword could be a fenofibrate. So every day we are learning new about this disease, and we are getting more and more randomized controlled trials about this disease. So it's a learning curve, but what we are doing is what is the best available collated evidence. So it's an evolving therapy. As I said, this virus is predictably unpredictable. So, you know, when you know that you are just becoming okay, you may suddenly deteriorate. So I think care and caution and vigilance is the order of the day when you are in COVID care. And most people will do well. So that 21 day to 28 day window is important. But the non-infectivity happens after 9 to 10 days. But we need to be vigilant. People need to take a rest for a month. Usually people can resume after 17 days after testing first positive. And usually at discharge, we don't need to do a COVID test. Even if the test is not done, it is okay. Because if you are more than 10 days in the disease, the virus is likely to be non-replicative. So let me make two confessions. I think most people are recovering on their own, with their own immune system. Okay, so let me be very transparent here. I don't want to make a claim that because these new medicines have come, people have recovered more. No, that's not correct. I think it's supportive care, oxygen, and their people's own body's immunity, which is making them recoverable. That is number one. Number two, you're very right. These are repurposed drugs. That means these drugs were already available, but we are repurposing them for COVID. So the first kid of the block is a very old drug for malaria called hydroxychloroquine. That is very useful in healthcare workers who are exposed to COVID environments. If you give them every week, then the doctors, healthcare workers, nurses are less likely to get it. So that is hydroxychloroquine. And in early disease, it may still have some use with azithromycin. So this is still under research mode. It's a repurposed drug. At least in India, we still have in the younger population using this hydroxychloroquine, azithromycin with some zinc, and it has been done quite well. But we need more database to show on that. The alternative to that also in the research mode is, these are also repurposed drugs called ivermectin and doxycycline. They are also undergoing research trials. So these are the, then we have a specific antiviral. This is a Japanese flu drug from 2015, which is called as favipiravir, again a tongue twister, available in Japan, in China, in Russia, now in India. This drug actually clears the virus fast. So if you use it the first 5 to 7 days, by a week, the viral shedding will occur. So, but it has a very lot of pill burden. So you have to take 9 tablets in the morning, 9 tablets at night on day 1, and then 4 tablets in the morning and night for 14 days, 13 days. So that is the favipiravir. Usually very good for mild cases. So that is the oral tablet. These are the oral tablets. Then if you get moderate COVID or severe COVID, which will need hospitalization, which will need oxygen. So patients on oxygen who are needing more and more oxygen and who are deteriorating, okay, and they are in the first 7 to 8 days, we give an injection called remdesivir. Remdesivir is an injection. It is a drug, it's again repurposed, used for Ebola. Ebola, you know, is a very dangerous African virus. And this drug has also got antiviral activities. Yes. And if we give it in an injection, moderate to severe cases, their recovery time in hospital improves. So they can go home faster. So that is called as remdesivir. So these are the antiviral drugs from that perspective. And we can contain the virus. So once the virus is in the body, we can manage it, and we wish most people are able to recover it. With the newer antivirals, you are very right what you said in the beginning. With the advent of these new drugs, we'll see the impact in the next month on the death rates. So the death rate will come down. We want to have a death rate less than 1%. In that, these antiviral drugs, the monoclonal antibodies, the plasma therapy, the oxygen therapy, all of them will help. and of course the steroids. So these are the game changer drugs. So clearly, but from a public health standpoint, we want to reduce the risk of transmission. And to reduce that risk of transmission, it has to be a people's movement. That I want you to take the message, you have to protect yourself. It has to be a self-protect mechanism. So you have to protect your own self. It could be, the next patient could be you. So to protect yourself, do a strict SMS. Whatever there is, this virus does not distinguish anybody. One slip up and you're gone. So ensure that strict sanitization. Soap and water is good enough. You don't need a hi-fi sanitizer for that. If you have a sanitizer, it's great. But soap and water is good enough. Mask, mask and mask. Mask, mask and mask. And the third thing which you need to do is do distancing if it is possible. And use a good quality mask. Keep the mask properly fitted. That's very, very important. That's very unlikely. I wish what you say is true and you will get a Nobel Prize for your prophecy. Okay. But I doubt that. Okay. Because we will need a vaccine. And vaccine will come, but it will take a time. It might take 6 months. It may take 1 year. It may take 1.5 years. We are trying to develop a vaccine. But till the vaccine comes, we need a social vaccine. And that social vaccine brand ambassador is you. You need to tell people to mask. If you mask, you can at least contain it and try to keep the virus at bay. So we can tame it with medicines, but we can actually tame the transmission by people's cooperation. That's the only way we can handle it till we get a vaccine. I wish what you're saying is that virus will just become a very innocent virus, but that is not happening. We wish wishful thinking, but it's still not happened. It has not mutated enough to become non-virulent, but we are building better immunity. So one fine day, let's hope what you're saying is true, but currently the evidence is not in that direction. You need to be positive, you need to be cheerful, you should be smiling, but don't be reckless, careless and stupid. Be careful, be cautious, don't be panicky, don't be negative. Mostly you will not get it. If you get it, you can handle it. There are doctors to handle it. You can handle it yourself, protect yourself. So I think I go with our Prime Minister of Atmanirbhar. We have to be self-reliant, self-sufficient and self-protective. And that's the way we are going. I think we are, despite of having 1.3 billion people, we have done extraordinarily well and we need to continue doing well. And let's hope and wish what you are hoping and praying, that we live in a virus-free world. Stay calm, stay safe, smile, but self-protect.
Doctors like Shashank Joshi have been going out daily, risking their lives, not only treating patients from this virus, but also giving us hope. Because that is what heroes do. We salute him for his efforts.